Okay.
It gets really long by the toilet.
Let's put your little mat.
Welcome, welcome everyone. Take a seat. I think this guy is very, very strong.
He's like a
welcome, Force Church.
Force Peter. Oh no.
Well, as we get started, why don't we begin with prayer and then we'll start our gathering. So let's pray together. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you so much that you have gathered all of us into this room together where we can meet you in your word. We pray that today, as we hear your word, help us to respond by faith. In Jesus' name, amen. It's great to see everyone here. I was reading Hebrews chapter 10. And just going through the bit about how we're meant to be thankful and find great confidence knowing that Jesus is our great high priest, it's really interesting because one of the things he says right after is this: and let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. The thing that really struck to me was the fact how closely the Christian life is to meeting together. It's part of what we do as Christians. Christians meet together. And it's great that we can do that in person now, in the flesh. So I'm really hoping that today, after the service, you feel, wow, this service, it actually helped me to be spurred on to love and good deeds. And maybe thinking about, how can I be a great encouragement to the person next to me? That's a question for you guys to think about as we sing our first song.
How great is your love for us? And tonight we want to lift up your name to thank you. For thank you for the provision of this community, for thanking you. Thank you for the gospel and for the hope that we have in Christ. And Lord God, we pray that you would transform us tonight as we hear you speak. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Shall we sing of the Lord of Lords?
Thank you.
You've gathered and dwell now within us. You've called us. And Lord God, tonight, may it be true of us that we would sing your praises both now and in the age to come, and that the things of this world will not sway us as we run till the race is finished. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. On to some announcements. So brothers and sisters, welcome back for our third week of Church at Five. And if you're joining us on Zoom, delighted to have you with us. And just a reminder that back to church means let's keep safe and make sure that we look after each other. And of course, those who are gathered here tonight, of course, we're going to keep our social distancing. We will get on chip for tea and coffee later on, but we're going to make sure we look after each other. And of course, if you use the bathrooms or anything, please make sure that you keep them clean. There we go. Let the reader understand. On to next Sunday. Each year we have an AGM at church. It's the annual general meeting. And it's a twofold meeting. It's a meeting to celebrate and thank the Lord for the ministries he's done in our midst over the last year. So we're going to put together a slideshow and capture some of those moments, and also spend some time electing and praying for those who will lead us in our parish. So we appoint parish councillors and wardens. We hear about the status of our money, and we think through where we, as the people of the Lord, are going to be travelling together. At this moment, I'm going to hand back over to Ira, who's going to bring us that next bit.
Thank you. So as you can see up on the screen, we've got Equip Eternity, and to help us understand what it is and how helpful it was for them, I'm going to invite Kylie and Belinda.
And Annabelle.
All right. Come on in. Everyone, give them a round of applause. it's great priority to come on stage like this, not knowing what questions you're... You'll be fine.
Go easy on us here.
Yeah, actually. Well, round number one. He says that Eternity Equip at Home. Now, what is the Equip Conference?
Well, most people know, but if you don't, Equip is an annual women's conference. It's been going for about 20 years. Usually it's Darling Harbour in the International Convention Centre with a few thousand women of all ages. But because of COVID, we are changing plans. You can watch it from the comfort of your lounge room, or we decided to watch it as a small group here, socially distanced in this room.
Right, okay. This question is for Belinda and Annabelle. So today we're going to look at 1 Timothy, the letter there, and it thinks about how we can fight the good fight of the faith. So what was one thing from yesterday's conference that helps you to fight the good fight of the faith?
For me, one of the main things that jumped out was the resurrection and the importance of the resurrection in the Christian life. We had two talks yesterday. There are two more talks next Saturday. And just hearing again about the resurrection and just how important it was to Christianity was something that just, stuck in my brain yesterday. And one of the speakers, Tash Leong, did an example of the resurrection with Jenga blocks, where the resurrection of Christ was the bottom block, and she had about 5 blocks on top. And basically she said, if you know the game of Jenga, which is the wooden blocks piled on top of each other, if you remove the wrong one, the whole thing collapses. And basically that's what they were saying, is that if the resurrection did not occur, then the Christian faith is sort of can collapse in that respect. So for me, it just struck a chord where it is so important that we acknowledge Christ dying for us on the cross.
Melanie, do I?
Well, Mum just about covered it all. That was a really nice recap of everything that happened on Saturday for those that weren't there. Yeah, but really just seeing how applicable to life the resurrection is. So even back then it was applicable, now it's still very applicable. And being a Christian, it all rests on the resurrection, really. So I think it was really encouraging to hear about just how much it means to us.
And Kylie, so it's the second episode is on the coming Saturday. If anyone here or online wants to participate, how can they?
It's not too late. You can easily register on the Equip website, and teenagers are free even, which is awesome. You can catch up on yesterday's talk in readiness for next week. But if not, just join us anyway. And we're going to talk about the resurrection body. What does it mean to be bodily resurrected, according to 1 Corinthians? It's
going to
be challenging, interesting, informative, and good times. 10 o'clock.
Great, thanks. Thanks so much for, I'm going to pray for them, and then we'll have our next set of interviews. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for the resurrection. Father, we know that without it, our faith is in vain, but we thank you that you are the one who raised Christ to be the King of the world. And we thank you so much for Kylie, for Belinda, for Annabelle, and for all the women in our church family who stood and sat and participated with many women around Sydney in Australia. We pray that this week that you would be continuing to work in their hearts to see the resurrection as the central thing of their Christian life. In Jesus' name, amen. Give them a round of applause. Yeah. All right, well, that is not all that's happening at here at St. John's. I'm going to invite Ralph and Lauren to come up now. Blast is the next thing. There we go. Now, it's Blast, but what's Blast off? What's happening there?
Yes, it's very exciting. It's happening during these holidays, and it's a way for us to officially start our Blast next term. And it's a way we're going to get kids to come here for a day, and we're going to have a few talks and a few games and a few different things, and it's a way we can be training up our Blast leaders as well.
Great, great. And so when is that on?
Yes, it is on the 17th of July, so the last Friday of the school holidays. That's
okay.
Coming up.
Great. So the last Friday of the coming up school holidays, last office happening. That's great.
Nine to five.
Okay, great. Lauren, if we want to be involved in any way, how can we be involved with Blast Off?
Yeah, so we'll be inviting all of the Blast kids and Blast leaders, and we'll also be inviting the NCAR leaders to come along to be trained up in this sort of ministry, because we'd love to see all the youth coming along and helping us serve. So if you're a youth, that goes out to you. But also, as members of the church, we'd just love prayer to be able, because obviously we can't do NRG in these holidays, which was normally what we'd be doing, but it's okay because we can look forward to NRG next holidays, in the September holidays. So it's also a good time for us to be sort of warming our fingers up again for a big program. It's like a warm-up mode. But prayer for wisdom and strength as leaders to be able to share the, we're talking about prayer, it's a considering thought at the moment, but looking at prayer and how we can be doing that more, and just prayer for us to be looking at prayer. And obviously if you would like to volunteer, please let us know. We obviously can't have a million volunteers because of our numbers and restrictions, but please let us know if you'd love to help volunteer on that day.
Great. And you mentioned NRG, so we're not having it this set of holidays. So what's happening with NRG?
Yes. So after consideration, we decided we're going to postpone NRG. So it's going to happen in 28th of September until the 2nd of October, which is the first week of the Term 3/4 holidays, which will be very exciting. And we're looking, our theme for this year is Knights, as you can see from the image. So it's very exciting.
Great, the Knights. Okay, great. So Blast Off is on the last Friday of coming school holidays, and NRG is on the first week of the Term 3/4. If you want to be involved in NRG, what can they do?
Also, come talk to me or Raph. If you ever want to help with any kids ministry, just talk to me or Raph. We'd love to have a conversation, and we'd love to have you volunteer.
Great, okay. I'm going to ask God for help, and then we'll move on to our next thing. Dear God, we thank you so much for our children and for the students at our schools here. And we just pray for all of them that you may be working in their hearts to call Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And we pray for the team taking care of Blast Off and NRG, that through their model of servant leadership, and as they continue to live godly lives, that you would use them to build up a new generation of people who are willing to give their lives for the sake of your gospel. We especially pray for Raph and Lauren and others involved in the team. Give them energy and help them to persevere. We pray all these things in your son's name. Amen. And great. Thank you. Thanks so much. Give them a round of applause. Well, for us, we come to a time where we'll be confessing to one another and to God, and reflecting on our life this past week. Also thinking about, as Christians, we do sin. What does that mean for us? And what does that mean for our identity as Christians? So this time of confession is a way of reminding us, that's right, we are saved because of Christ. So I'm going to read this. We are the people of God. The scripture reminds us that we still sin. We need to confess our failures, knowing that Jesus intercedes for us with the Father, who freely forgives us. So let us all draw near to God with sincerity and confidence. Let's pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have gone our own way, not loving you as we ought, nor loving our neighbour as ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We deserve your condemnation. Father, forgive us. Help us to love you and our neighbour, and to live for your honour and glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. This is the good news of Christianity. Our God fulfills his promises and is true to his word. We have confessed our sins. God has forgiven us because Christ died for us. Here's some scriptures. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good,
His steadfast love endures forever.
Well, as we come to his word, we're going to say this prayer. Thank you, Father, for making yourself known to us, showing us the way of salvation through faith in your Son. We ask you now to teach us through your word so that we may be ready to serve you. The glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The Kai is going to ring up our prayers.
From Psalm 86. Hear me, Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Guard my life, for I am faithful to you. Save your servant who trusts in you. You are my God. Have mercy on me, Lord, for I call to you all day long. Bring joy to your servant, for I put my trust in you. You, Lord, are forgiving and good, abounding in love to all who call to you. Hear my prayer, Lord. Listen to my cry for mercy. When I am in distress, I call to you, because you answer me. Among the gods, there is none like you, Lord. No deeds can compare with yours. All the nations you have made will come and worship before you, Lord. They will bring glory to your name. For you are great and do marvelous deeds. You alone are God. Teach me your way, Lord, that I may rely on your faithfulness. Give me an undivided heart, that I may fear your name. I will praise you, Lord my God, with all my heart. I will glorify your name forever. For great is your love toward me. You have delivered me from the depths and from the realm of the dead. Arrogant foes are attacking me, O God. Ruthless people are trying to kill me. They have no regard for you. But you, Lord, are a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. Turn to me and have mercy on me. Show your strength in behalf of your servant. Save me because I serve you just as my mother did. Give me a sign of your goodness that my enemies may see it and be put to shame. For you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hey, well, brothers and sisters, we've started our series on 1 Timothy last week. We're going to be reading through chapter 1 again. Just a reminder, Paul is training up his young intern, Timothy. He's on his missionary journeys as per normal for Paul. He's ended up in a place called Macedonia, and Timothy is just keen to be in the Macedonia and being with Paul and supporting him and getting on with the work. But Paul says, hey, Timothy, I need you to stay in Ephesus and sort some stuff out. And so he writes this letter. 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the command of God our Saviour, and of Christ Jesus our hope, to Timothy my true son in the faith, grace, mercy and peace from God the Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. As I urged you when I went to Macedonia, stay there in Ephesus so that you may command certain people not to teach false doctrines any longer, or devote themselves to myths and endless genealogies. Such things promote controversial speculations rather than advancing God's work, which is by faith. The goal of this command is love, which comes from a pure heart, a good conscience, and a sincere faith. Some have departed from these, have turned to meaningless talk. They want to be teachers of the law, but they do not know what they're talking about or what they so confidently affirm. We know that the law is good if one uses it properly. We also know that the law is made not for the righteous, but for lawbreakers and rebels, the ungodly and sinful, the unholy and irreligious, for those who kill their fathers or mothers, for murderers, for the sexually immoral, for those practicing homosexuality, for slave traders and liars and perjurers, and for whatever else is contrary to the sound doctrine that conforms to the gospel concerning the glory of the blessed God which he entrusted to me. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me trustworthy, appointing me to his service, even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man. I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord Jesus was poured out onto me abundantly, along with faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. He is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Now, Timothy, my son, I'm giving you this command in keeping with the prophecies once made about you, so by recalling them, you may fight the battle well, holding on to faith and a good conscience, which some have rejected and so suffered shipwreck with regard to their faith. Among them are Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I've handed over to Satan to be taught not to blaspheme. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Brothers and sisters, I've heard some good stories from a number of you in small groups, and this series is running in conjunction with our Bible study series. If you're not in Bible study, great, get into one, because it's that way of learning from the Lord together and supporting and encouraging each other and also rebuking each other. This evening, I want to focus on the Apostle Paul as he communicates through this part of his letter to Timothy. I want to title the sermon, Forgiven Sinners, Sing of Our King's Honor and Glory Forever. Forgiven Sinners, Sing of Our King's Honor and Glory Forever. We're going to have a look at Paul's experience, and then we're going to see how Paul uses his own experience to charge his young intern Timothy to fight the good fight. And he's going to fight as he opposes two types of myths. The first type of myth, people who try to undermine the truth about how you become a Christian. And the second kind of myth, people who try to whitewash or rip apart the faith by trying to take away or add to the teaching of the Lord Jesus about what a Christian should do. And then we're going to finish with an exhortation for us to be, in like fashion to Timothy, fighting the good fight together. Well, of course, our story tonight starts then with that wonderful story that we so remember of Saul's conversion on the road to Emmaus. And we remember Saul, don't we? He's a Pharisee of Pharisees. He would have memorized the first five books of the Bible. He knew the Bible backwards, but he did not know God. And so even though he had great head knowledge, when he heard of Jesus, he didn't embrace him as Lord and Savior because he had not yet met God. And rather, his desire is to try to shut down what he saw was heresy. And we know that Paul will use violence, and he's on his way to Emmaus to bust the next Christian cell group. And the Lord Jesus will speak to him from that blinding light, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? And so the Lord Jesus in kindness will enter Paul's experience and show him grace and mercy. Paul writes about it this way, verse 12, I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me trustworthy, appointing me to his service. I was a blasphemer. I misused the name of God. I misused the name of Jesus. And I was a persecutor by it, and I held the cloaks whilst the men and women were stoning Stephen to death. I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of the Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that in Christ Jesus. And it's interesting to stop and think about that. Paul explains that his life of persecuting Jesus actually came through ignorance and unbelief. Now, on the one hand, that sounds strange, but on the other hand, it makes perfect sense. If you're not in Christ, you're in darkness to God's plans and purposes. You are ignorant to the life that can be ours in relationship with Christ. And in the book of Romans, Paul explains the problem of sin like this. He says that it's so pervasive that even though it's obvious that the Lord Jesus created the world, because of sin, our thinking and our hearts and our minds and our judgments are all dulled and weakened so that we become worse and we don't even know about it. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. You see, you can go to church for years, but live in ignorance. You can have all this data about Jesus and know your Bible back to front, but have never met him. And you'll be living in ignorance and unbelief. That's all of us But the Lord Jesus, in his kindness, enters Paul's experience and shows him kindness and grace and opens his eyes literally to the truth of the gospel. And so now Paul's life is transformed, and a man goes from persecuting God to a man who will seek to strive to glorify the Lord Jesus in all ways. And it's almost like he uses his own example to encourage Timothy in the task that Timothy's got about to do. God has poured out immense patience on Paul to transform him. And on the basis of that, what can Paul do? He can now move towards encouraging those round about him who are also in darkness. He knows sin because he's lived it, but he can also urge people to move on from sin, to repent, to live a life that brings glory and honor to Jesus. Here's a light photo that will bring about some mirth, I'm sure. Yes, this is a photo taken in 1987, I believe, and I'm sitting next to Charlie Gremmel. Charlie led me to know the Lord Jesus in my backyard, year 9 student. I'd grown up and I had a wonderful upbringing of being taught to pray, of going to church, but I was in darkness. I hadn't met Jesus personally. And I was reading a Bible verse from Romans 5, Ephesians 2, and for the first time it tweaked that I was a sinner. And it dawned on me that I kept on thinking about sin as the axe murderer over there, but it's me. I'm the rebel against the Lord Jesus, and he has shown me mercy. And I was just struck. And my life transformed straight away. I said, Lord, I want to come into a relationship with you. I'm sorry for my sin. Please rescue me. And the Lord in his kindness did that. So I share that experience of Paul, and my sister could probably give you some reflections of my junior high days, and they weren't something I'm proud of, but the Lord brings about a transformation in our lives. And of course, I'm a forgiven sinner, Paul's a forgiven sinner, and you're a forgiven sinner. But forgiveness of sin sets us free, though, and sets us free to bring glory and honor to the Lord. And so you move from being in darkness and ignorance to understanding the kindness of the Lord Jesus, which then leads you to praise and honor. So after telling us of his own experience, what does Paul do? He speaks about the gospel and he says, Christ Jesus has shown such patience, and then he pours out this line of praise. Now to verse 17, now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. And his life is now transformed from being self-centered, only concerned about himself, to being firstly concerned about the glory and honor of the Lord Jesus. And then how he might encourage and equip the saints to love the Lord and also help those in darkness round about him. And that is something that's brought about by the grace of the Lord Jesus. As he's reminding Timothy this, he's reminding him because he knows that's also Timothy's story, but also that Timothy's got a task so as to make sure that others can follow in the same footsteps. Wouldn't it be great if the Lord gave us all that Emmaus Road experience of the blinding light and being in hospital for 3 days, only for the Lord open our sight again? But for most of us, we hear about the Lord Jesus through the public reading of Scripture, through the Bible being taught, either a friend over a coffee, or either on the radio or through a Scripture class. We hear the great news of Jesus. At the same time we hear the great news of Jesus, though, there are many round about us that are going to try to take us away from this joyful relationship with the Lord. And on to the rest of the passage, where now Paul will remind Timothy that this is great news, what the Lord has done in both of our lives, but to remind him that there are two versions of heresy that are going around, and they've been going around then and going around today. The first one talks about a failure to understand how one becomes a Christian. The second one talks about a failure about understanding what the Christian life should look like. Well, on to the first one. Morality is relationship. Brothers and sisters, I don't know how hard it is to do ministry here in North Ryde when people think good people go to church. And if you're good enough, you'll go to heaven. Is this right or wrong? It's completely false, isn't it? It's a load of rubbish. But it's exactly what the evil one wants people to think. And it is such a woeful lie. In the days of Paul and Timothy, those Jews who had heard about Jesus thought, right, okay, well, I'm hearing that Jesus is God, but you know what? You can't become a Christian until you become a Jew, and you've got to become a Jew by keeping the Old Testament laws. And so there's Cecil B. DeMille holding up the Ten Commandments, and it's always like, oh, you want to become a Christian? You must keep the law first. What an absolute shocker. It's a travesty. Paul reminds Timothy, teach against that heresy. What is the purpose of the Old Testament? What is the purpose of the very first part of our Bible? Should we rip it out of our Bible or should we leave it there? If it's wrong, why do we keep it there? Paul explains it like this. He says to Timothy, hey Timothy, I want to remind you about the Old Testament. We know that the law is good if you use it properly. We know that the law is made not for the righteous, but for the lawbreakers and rebels. See, when did God give Moses the Ten Commandments? He gave the Ten Commandments after Israel had been rescued out of Egypt. God had already entered in kindness a relationship with his people. And it's on the basis of being in relationship, the law is given that they might stay in relationship. It's not how you enter in. You'll move on into Romans 3, a letter probably written at a very similar time. No one will be declared righteous in God's sight by keeping the law. All the law does is tell you that you can't keep it. As soon as you hear, don't think about the pink spotted elephant, immediately you think about the pink spotted elephant. The law reminds you that as hard as you want to say that I'm going to be obedient following God, you won't get there, which thrusts you towards the mercy and the kindness of God, which of course all the prophets and the Psalms point towards Jesus, because they knew the law did not change hearts and minds. Rather, it enforced people in sin, looking for salvation by faith. And therefore, do you throw out the Old Testament? By no means. You read the Old Testament for encouragement because it points you towards Jesus. The very end of the letter of Romans, Romans 15, everything was written in the past. The Old Testament was written to teach us, both those in Rome and also us in North Ryde, that through the endurance taught in those messy, ugly stories of the Old Testament, that we might have hope in the Lord Jesus, salvation by grace alone. So Timothy, when someone starts rambling on about a false way of connecting to God, a false way of becoming a Christian, you must stop that teaching. You must rebuke, because that teaching will stop people connecting with the Lord Jesus. The second heresy that he addresses is the response error. That is, now that I'm in Christ, well, do I listen to the Lord Jesus to find out how I should live? Or rather, do I make up my own version as to what a godly, obedient Christian looks like? Relationship, is said by some, does not need a response of faith and obedience. I enjoyed working with a team of people to build some shelves in the preschool, and they looked beautiful. I was very happy with the construction. Only a couple of years later to find out that white ants were happily having their lunch. And of course, the wonderful construction all went down the drain to the tip. And it was a sad moment, because we put a lot of time and effort into that. And we figured that, you know, we could actually find a nest of termites outside. So we figured that there's probably one or two termites in one of the pieces of wood that came from Bunnings that were used to build our lovely shelves. And of course, those termites decided to make a queen, and the queen decides to lay a lot more eggs and bye-bye shelves. Brothers and sisters, there are teachings and patterns of life that are just like the white ant, the termite, which look in, that you just don't know it's there. But then after a time, it starts to destroy the work of God. See, Paul's vision is that the church will be focused on the glory of Jesus, to be focused on the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. And that honor comes, as we're reminded by Jesus, we hear him speak and we obey his commands. Jesus says, if you love me, you'll keep my commands. And sadly, in Paul's experience, even though the church is only a few decades after the death and resurrection of Jesus, already there had been men and women teaching things that were not bringing glory and honor to the Lord Jesus, either through something they taught or through a pattern of their life. Now, of course, we love to think the church is all it's all nice and we're all smiley and friendly all the time and it's a perfect place to be. But Paul reminds Timothy that anything that brings down the church of God, any teaching, any pattern of life which doesn't conform to the wonderful news of Jesus, needs to be dealt with. It's like a gangrene. And if it's not dealt with, then it will lead to people shipwrecking their faith. Their teaching will spread like gangrene. Amongst them is Hymenaeus and Philetus, who have departed from the truth. They say that the resurrection has already taken place, and they destroy the faith of some. Now, this guy Hymenaeus, we read in the second letter to Timothy, has got some warped teaching about the resurrection. We don't know what it is. It could be something like this. Oh, did you not know the Lord Jesus died and he rose again? And he's come back again. So now we're living in this wonderful world where the Lord Jesus has forgiven us all. Everyone's going to heaven. And it doesn't really matter how you live now, because when you die, everyone goes to heaven. What a disastrous teaching. We don't know if that's what it was. But there's lots of versions of that. Our version of the prosperity gospel has that idea. It's called an over-realized eschatology. The idea that the blessings of heaven can be imported into life now. Therefore, pursue health, wealth, and wisdom. Brothers and sisters, a false teaching that brings about destruction. And of course, what does Paul instruct Timothy? He must speak to these people and stop them from teaching that pattern. And verse 20, he says, both Hymenaeus and Alexander, whatever their teaching was, I've handed over to Satan to be taught not to blaspheme. Now, we are going to have a brief question time at the end. You might want to ask me a bit more about that verse. But just know this, where is Satan ruled? Well, he rules outside of the church. So what has Paul decided? This teaching is so destructive to the word of God that these men must not attend church anymore. They must be thrown outside of the church to see the seriousness of ensuring that both our teaching and our pattern of life matches up with the wonders that we have in the Lord Jesus. Well, brothers and sisters, we come now to the final exhortation to Timothy, where Timothy is now urged to fight the good fight. See, Paul wanted to remind him of the wonderful joy of being saved. It's a great moment of knowing the Lord Jesus personally, but then to remind Timothy what his earthly job will be. Let's pick it up. Verse 18, Timothy, my son, I'm giving you this command in keeping with the prophecies once made about you, and so that by recalling them you may fight the battle well, holding on to faith and a good conscience, which some have rejected. Now, prophecy is one of those difficult questions for us. We stop and think, well, if God's made himself clear in the Bible, where do prophecies fit in? Now, brothers and sisters, I like the phrase from the book of Revelation that prophecy is testimony to Jesus. And about 18 years ago, I was ordained as an Anglican minister. Now, what did that process involve? There were some godly Christians that had spent some time thinking about me, and they said, look, John, based on the past, it appears that you've loved the Lord Jesus and desired to build his church. Today, we're giving you an ordination, so we're blessing you so as to continue doing that in the future. And on the day the Archbishop spoke, and he spoke prophetically, praying that our future would be that future of fighting for the truth of the gospel, remembering the grace of God, yet also ensuring that the church of God hears the clarity of the gospel. As it seems like that was Timothy's experience, that the brothers and sisters had acknowledged in this young man his love of the Lord Jesus and said, Lord, please use this man to the future to build your church. And so Timothy was urged to remind that ordination, to remind it of those prophecies, and to continue in his ministry, which was going to be exceptionally difficult. Difficult because those around about him who should have, often men older than him, would not continue in faith and would not have a good conscience of a life that echoed the clarity of the gospel. And of course, what was his job? On the one hand, to encourage, yet also to rebuke these men. Fight the battle well. It is a battle because, of course, where is the evil one going to attack? Is he not going to attack in our understanding of the gospel? Is he not going to attack in terms of what patterns of life we will tolerate in each other in terms of bending that glory and honor that's due to the Lord Jesus? Hold on to faith and a good conscience, Timothy. Know that some around you have shipwrecked not only their own faith, but the faith of others through teaching things that were false. So, brothers and sisters, if we come to the end of our thinking this evening, to stop and think how we're going in terms of fighting the good fight. It's interesting that Paul uses this analogy right at the start, chapter 1, and then he'll flick through right at the end of the book to bring up this analogy of fighting the good fight again, as he's gone through a whole bunch of pastoral issues that would be very tricky for the church. And this young man, Timothy, is to remember the grace of the Lord Jesus, his kindness, but now that someone is saved, how to live in a community which honours the Lord Jesus. We're going to spend some time in prayer. I want us tonight to thank the Lord for his kindness in saving each and every one of us. And now that we're saved, that we each individually, and that we as a church, be passionate about the glory and honour of the Lord. And of course, if we're passionate about that glory and honour, then we're going to have to make some hard calls about what's going on in our community. But we do so out of love. And we do so to ensure that the next generation can hear the truth of the gospel. Now let's pray, and if you'd like to ask a question, then we'll have that time in a few moments. Father God, we come before you now remembering that day when we came to know you. And just the peace that we experience. Some of us, Lord, we know of growing up with you and can't remember a time when we weren't in a relationship, but others know that moment of knowing peace with you, being set free from that burden and weight of sin that we could do nothing about, and being so filled with joy in that first love and that zeal and the desire to be in response and thanks to give you glory and honour. And Lord God, we pray that that would be what captures us as a church community. Yet, Lord, we don't have to look far, both within us, the people who have been once here with us and no longer with us, the threat and the disaster of false teaching. But Father God, please, in your kindness, keep us true to the message of your servant, the Lord Jesus. In your kindness, Lord, help us to speak to each other in love, that we might fight and struggle together for the honour of your Son, by ensuring that what we do and our practices honour your Son. And Lord God, just as your servant Paul encouraged Timothy to fight, may we too fight for your glory, honour, here in North Ryde. Around about us there is every sad teaching under the sun, and it grieves us, Lord, to hear so much confusion about the gospel. In your kindness, Lord, we pray that we indeed might be men and women that do present the great news of Jesus to this suburb and beyond, and that others round about us might be filled with joy knowing your Son as Lord and Saviour. We pray this in his name. Amen. So now's the time to ask any questions. Hymenaeus and Alexander, yes.
Out because of gangrene and in the church, would they not be concerned they would then go out into the greater community?
Yeah, exactly. And that's effectively what happened. That's effectively what happened. So it's a bit like when we recite the Apostles' Creed, which we will do tonight. It's the moment of saying, this is what the teaching of the church has been since the Lord Jesus. And there are many heresies that have sadly existed. I caught Tara reminded me about the bus stop, the Christian Science Reading Room bus stop at Rye. I'm going to over this. Oh, unbelievable. Now, they're all dead and gone, but there's other heresies around, the J-Dubs and the Mormons and others. And of course, you stop there. How could they exist? Well, it's because, sadly, people won't open their Bible and will not read it. And that's exactly what Parmenas and Alexander would have done, would have planted churches. And Paul experienced that, particularly you read about that in 2 Corinthians, how there's a bunch of other churches that have formed around these so-called eloquent, trained preachers who taught heresy. People heard it, and of course, if you're the evil one and you want to destroy the work of God, what's one of the best ways of doing it? Polluting the teaching of the church, both in what is taught and what practices are condoned. And so that's exactly what Paul had to contend with. So the point of being alone, feeling rejected and deserted, but of course we're here today, and I trust that we're in the Lord because of both the ministry of Paul and Tim. But you're right, exactly. I mean, let's be honest, there was a man that was hiring our building here who was doing a Jewish sect, and I was concerned about, I came to one of his meetings, was concerned about it. I talked to a couple of my friends who are former Jews, now Christians, and they warned me about this man's teaching. They knew all about it. And so I politely said to the man, sadly, you can't use the facility any further. But that hasn't stopped him. He's just had some rest, which is a bit sad.
John, it talks about fulfilling prophecies made about you. Are there specific prophecies that are linked to Timothy?
Yes, we don't know anything more than what's in the text here. We do know that he had a wonderful Christian heritage as a young man. He learned the gospel through his grandma, through Lois. It's a wonderful story. And we can only but imagine that he's one of those guys which you look at him and you say, you know what, he is so blessed with a love for the Lord Jesus and a capacity to teach. And I can almost guarantee that the elder of the church would have said, brother, I know that you'd be a great, you know, sailmaker like Paul was before he became a Christian, okay? But it's time for you possibly to leave the sailmaking, because we think, we feel that the Lord will use you mightily in his kingdom. So please consider giving that up and joining the ministry. And so it could have been something more specific for the Lord. We just don't know. The Lord Jesus can do whatever he wants. There's been a number of moments here at church where people said, I've got a prophecy for the Lord. And the biblical mechanism for a prophecy is to say, well, we're not saying it's not from the Lord. Let's gather the elders around to consider, may this be a word from the Lord. In a number of people who have given me prophecies, they haven't been prepared to do that, which kind of indicates, well, it probably wasn't a word from the Lord because they didn't want to have it verified. But certainly this idea of identifying young men and women to give up their lives to serve the Lord Jesus is something which I think is very biblical. And certainly there's been people that have encouraged me in that way over the years. And my guess is that's also been the case for Michael and Simon Ire and Matt, just to say, look, you know what, this is where we love to see your gifts and skills used. Just on that, the Archbishop. We're living in very trying times, brothers and sisters, no question about that. The Anglican Church in Sydney is under stress, and we are declining in size. And next year, we're exceedingly worried about what's going to happen to college. There will be an enormous impact on enrolments. And of course, that then has a flow on to leadership in the church. 30 Anglican parishes are without rectors at the moment, and it's a very difficult time. My guess is, in the next couple of years, there will be a significant number of church closures, but it's never labelled that in Anglican speak. It's amalgamation. The Archbishop said, we must pray for the next generation to be raised up to be gospel men and women. And so if you see gifts and skills in one of your brothers and sisters, tap them on the shoulder and say, have you thought about service in the kingdom of God? And that could be of any age. It's not just young people. It can be of any age, because it's so urgent. So he's got the Archbishop has a date. I think it's the 14th of August. I've registered already. If you want to join me in that event, Andrew Bird is speaking, and I guess Mark Thompson and others are speaking. Have they said anything at college about this?
Yeah, they sent an email. I can send it and post it on our Facebook group. You can have a look there. I'll find out and maybe give some more information next week.
Yeah. So that's a long roundabout question about prophecy. But I think that's the idea here, is that Timothy in the moment, look, this is hard for him. He is going to have to say some really hard things. And he's going to be very unpopular when he does that. And what does he need to be reminded of? This is the work of the pastor of this church, and Paul needs him to do it. He needs him to stay in Ephesus to do this really difficult job. And at the moment, when it just seems so bleak and so hard to do, because he's not going to make any friends doing it, well, he will in those that love the Lord Jesus. We might call our quits to our questions there and stop to remind each other about how deep the Father's love is for us. So let's we'll sing, and as we sing this song, as we lead it for you guys, let's stop and reflect on the Lord's love for us and how that should lead us to praise for the glory and honor of God. How deep. One day you'll be able to sing with us. Here we go.
Lead us in prayer for three things. and pray for our Mandarin service, the AGM next week, and also small business owners around the world. So let's pray together. Dear God, we thank you that you are a God of order. We thank you that you are our greatest authority. But Father, we thank you so much that you have given men and women who are willing to give their lives for your service. So we thank you so much for our ministry staff, our wardens, our parish counselors, and we thank you so much for our treasurer, Bruce. We thank you for their hard work through this year. And as we spend a couple of minutes next week reviewing our year's ministry, help us to have hearts of thankfulness, knowing that you are the God who gives us provisions, and you are the God who gives us growth. We pray for wisdom and courage to make godly decisions for the next year. And we pray that people will put Jesus first in these decisions. And the people who will be asked to serve, we pray that we would choose people who put Jesus first. Father, we thank you so much that you have given the gospel not just to Jews, but to Gentiles like us. And we especially thank you so much for the gospel going out to Mandarin speakers. We pray for Simon and Michael and their teams, and we pray that through them you would continually call Chinese people into the gospel. We pray that, especially after Zoom and trying to get back to face-to-face, you would convict the Christians in this congregation to come and meet together face-to-face. We pray that you would uphold Simon and Michael and help them not to be discouraged, while we pray that you would help them to be spurred on with energy. We pray for all their small group Bible studies that they do on Sundays. We pray for the ESL and the Learn Chinese classes. All these opportunities help them to be used so that people can know how great and loving that you are. And Father, we thank you so much for being the God of provisions. We thank you for using small businesses to provide for us. But Father, we ask that in these difficult times that you would provide for them. Help them to love and take care of their families. But also help us, as people who love our neighbours, to love them, especially those who are part of our church family. Help us to think about them and to pray for them. But Father, most importantly, we do pray that you would save each and every one of the people who are involved in small businesses here at North Ryde. Please help them to be part of our church family here at St. John's. We pray all these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to say the Lord's Prayer together. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread.
Forgive
us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Be exalted, Lord, above the heavens.
Let your glory cover the earth.
Keep our nation under your care.
And guide us in justice and truth.
Let your way be known on earth.
Your saving power among all nations.
Send out your light and truth.
That we may tell your saving works.
Hear our prayers, O Lord.
For we put our trust in you.
We're going to reflect on the words of our next song.
Oh, your resurrection power burns my victorious. You are stronger than our hearts. You are greater than the dark. With you, we are victorious. Nothing is impossible. Every chain is breakable. With you, we are victorious. You are stronger than our hearts. You are greater than the dark. With you, we are victorious.
To fight the good fight of the faith, let's be encouraged. We're going to say these words of the grace.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
Great. Well, continue encouraging one another, and I'll